Okay, thank you, Datin Paduka Marina Mahathir, for agreeing to be on Penang Institute Chat. Yeah. You are one of the most famous Malaysians when it comes to social activism. I'm sure you know that. And you've been involved in a long range of heated issues, I think, throughout your life, right? You were on the forefront when it came to HIV, AIDS, of course, gender issues. You've always been upfront, immigration. And you're a key member of the Sisters in Islam as well, still, aren't you? Now, today I would like to ask what you think of the following issue. What key measures are needed today, post-GE, post-general election 14, on May 9th this year, to improve gender parity substantially in Malaysia, both in the private and the public sector?
Well, I think one of the key measures was actually promise in the Pakatan Manifesto, which is the 30% allocation for women in all decision-making positions. This was something that we signed up to at the CEDAW, the Convention for Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, way back in 95. And we still haven't really taken steps to achieve it, so we're hoping the new government will take it more seriously. Decision-making positions at all levels, in the private sector and the public sector. For instance, women on boards, boards of companies. Mm-hmm. The last government also pushed for that. Unfortunately, it hasn't quite taken. People are still giving excuses not to do it. Mm-hmm. But I think the more important sector is politics. Women in politics, all the way from election candidates to the cabinet. So in the last election, unfortunately, we didn't have enough number of female candidates that would give us 30% in parliament. So it has to start at the candidate level. You need more than 30% of candidates to be women in order to get 30% into parliament. So we have, I think, slightly more than before, but it's around, still around 10-11%, if I'm not wrong, which is very, you know, very low still. In the cabinet, the women's groups are pushing for 30% of cabinet to be female. And although we have more women ministers than ever before, we have 5 this time, and several deputy ministers, is still nowhere near the 30%.
So 5 which out of 30,
yeah? Yeah, which should be about 10, you know, around 9 or 10. But that also is because the political parties needed to name female candidates for cabinet posts, and if they don't, you know, the choice is not there. So I think that is what is very necessary, because with that number of women in the cabinet, say, and in parliament, women's voices will be heard more, women's issues will be raised more, and then we might actually, you know, get serious about gender equality in the country.
Yeah, and their perspectives are not something that men can imagine for themselves, right? They have to be told that in the boardrooms, as you say, and in parliament itself.
Absolutely.
So you're thinking that the push has to come from, maybe not from below and not from up, from above either, but perhaps from somewhere in the middle.
I think it has to be both ways, because policies need to be grounded in the lived realities of women. And it's the grassroots women that have to speak out about what their lives are really like. And then the policies and laws need to address real life issues and not imaginary issues.
One thing I noticed in Sweden, I was living there quite a few years, how they started in the 60s was simply kindergartens. They invested a lot in kindergartens, and that freed up a lot of women. And once that got going, society started changing, I think. Yeah. And also, of course, many of these women went to work in kindergarten, strangely enough, right? That has to be it as well. But then very quickly, you saw that women were free to work and invest in work and yes. in their professional life, and very quickly it gets into politics, it gets into the boardroom, and then things get rolling.
Yeah.
Would something like that work?
Yeah, I think childcare is a huge issue in Malaysia. It's a huge issue for many families, and because of the cost, because of safety and things. I think the Ministry of Women is taking steps to register childcare facilities, because there have been so many cases of abuse or worse, you know. And I think that's something that needs to be looked at, childcare that are safe, that are reasonable.
Professional.
Because, you know, a lot of women are having to stay home simply because there's nobody to take care of their children. Some companies are providing childcare facilities, but not a whole lot. So all this, if you want women to work, then you need to have an environment that supports it.
Mm-hmm. So where is the resistance coming from? Or is it just simple, unthinking men who are stopping?
Well, know, men have had
feminism.
It easy. They get up in the morning, they go to work, you know. It's male privilege, mm-hmm. and that's why we need more women in politics, in decision-making positions, to bring the real life. It's like, okay, you go to work, but I have to prepare the children for school, and if they're sick, I'm the one who has to go and take them to the doctors. These are very real life issues, and they need to be addressed, because you can't hold it against me when I can't work or I can't take time off work because I'm having to be a mother. On the one hand, you want me to be a good mother.
Right.
But on the other hand, you're making it difficult. Mm. It doesn't make sense, you know.
But the quota system that you mentioned, 30%, will that work? Is that enough?
I think it works, because what it does is that it normalizes women in these sectors. You know, once people get used, you know, the myth is that if you have women in these positions, they're going to be so emotional and they're going to be difficult and all that. Well, you don't notice until they're there, mm-hmm. you know. And a lot of people who have had women on their boards and all that are finding, no, they're good workers, they're bringing new ideas, and business is better because of it, you mm-hmm. know, because of that diversity in the boardroom leads to more diversity in thinking, and you know, you might get new markets because of that.
As you say, it's a normalization you need, right? It's
a
socialization.
Once people get used to it, yes. then it's normal.
Yeah,
then it's normal. And that's so CEDAW recommends that the 30% is the tipping point, if you like.
Okay, 30 does seem reasonable.
Yeah, it's not 50, you know.
No, well, 20 I find. Well, that's one in five. That doesn't
yeah,
quite do
it. It's still a minority. Yes, you know, 30 is a kind of, okay, a strong minority.
Then, yeah, that might. The men in the boardroom will have to consider the fact that there are women sitting there,
yes.
and can't be ignored. And
right.
that would just about do it, I suppose. I do agree. You have to start somewhere, and that seems like a very substantial goal to aim for.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Marina.
I
think that's
welcome.
All the time we have. I wish we could talk more.
Yes.
Another time, perhaps.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
Happy Malaysia Day.
You too. Happy Malaysia Day.